love on fire. All aboard. Let's go to church.
Well, how's everybody doing tonight? This is our 27th Christmas, 23rd with Love on Fire. It's been quite a few of them. We're going to kind of give you a little bit of the Christmas feel tonight through testimony, through music, through prayer. And we just hope that it gives you a little bit of a touch of the Christmas season in the midst of what is quickly turning back to where we started from. But I think there's no better place when we think about Christmas than to think about Jesus, and he is the reason for the season. Oh, what a wonderful child.
Life, you hope,
So here we are in San Diego. Born and raised here all my life, 3 years in Phoenix, not much difference when it comes to weather. So Christmas time can be anywhere from a rainy day, cloudy day, to an 85 degree Santa Ana day. And we've had many of those. I can remember gifts that I got from my kids, and on Christmas Day, they couldn't use them because it just wasn't cold enough to use them or it wasn't fun enough to use them. But if you're from other parts of this country, then you know that there are many, many seasons other than the two seasons we experience here in San Diego, which is good and better. The rest of the world, they have fall, winter, spring, and summer. And of course, Christmas time brings out the best in what some people feel is the season, and that's snow time. Back in New York, you see the streets of white and the twinkling of the lights. You see the trees as they have turned gold during the autumn time, and then during Christmas time, the leaves fall and you have the snow that rests upon the branches. And it is a beautiful sight to wake up in the morning and see a fresh fallen snow. Many stories of Christmas have talked about that. So we're going to do a song that, although it may not be one you'll see much in San Diego, but you will see it in the rest of the world. It's called Winter Wonderland.
The green are you lifting in the lane? Snow is listening. A beautiful sight, we're happy tonight. We're walking in a winter wonderland. Gone away is the bluebird. In his place is a new bird. Sings a love song as we go along.
All right, Elvis has left the building. A song that always brings back memories for me. My sister was born in Memphis, Tennessee, and Elvis Presley was always a big part of our household. So anyway, I just want to welcome you all to Love on Fire tonight. We're going to pray in just a moment, but again, I just want to emphasize that this is the Christmas season, and it doesn't matter what's going on out there. It doesn't matter what's going on around here. It only matters what's going on in here. And if in here you have Jesus, and if in here you know he's the reason for the season, then you will find some type of blessing at this Christmas season. And we're going to talk about many things that Christmas might mean to you. I'm going to ask for a couple one-word descriptions. But right now, let's just start by saying hello to Melanie down there.
Greetings.
Right back there behind her, say hi to Eric. Right here, say hi to Tutima. She always looks really Christmassy. Right here, say hi to Dave. Right behind me, hi to David. He also looks pretty Christmassy, I gotta give him that. Looks like he's getting ready to go out and chop down the Christmas tree, watching one too many Christmas vacations. I'm Jeff. Over here on the far right with us this week is Stan. Say hi to Stan over there. From all of us, for the first time tonight, we wanna wish you a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And we just want to take a moment, let's bow our heads and let's pray for the Christmas season. Dear Heavenly Father, we just come to you tonight, Lord. We thank you for the book of Luke. We thank you for the story that you bring us of Christmas time. And we know that Christmas is a time of giving. For you answered prophecy by giving your son through the immaculate birth, bringing him to this planet so we would have Emmanuel with us, God with us. Lord, we know that just 33 years later, you gave again, for you gave your son on the cross for our sins, that all who believe in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And in the midst of that, Lord, you teach us to be giving, to give of our time, to give of our money, to give out of our abundance. And Lord, we no longer have to think about how much we have compared to somebody else's. All we have to do is just think about what you have given us. And it doesn't take very long before we see each and every one of us how blessed each and every one of us is. And in the midst of that, Lord, may we this year be able to give out to someone we come in contact with a joyous spirit of Christmas, knowing that Jesus is in our hearts. And because he's in our hearts, we can have the joy that comes from knowing that one day we will stand with you in heaven, where there'll be no more tears, where there'll be no more sorrow, where there'll be no more pain, and there'll be no more afflictions. And we will be able to truly answer the call when you say at the gate, good and faithful servant, you have been good with a little. Now come in and enjoy your master's happiness. So Lord, this season, may we remember that through everything we do. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, so let's get some Woodward answers. We did this song last week for you. We're going to do it again right now. And I'm just going to, sometimes it's hard to put it into one word, but I want you to look for one word that says, what does Christmas mean to you? So just shout them out. If you've got a word of what Christmas means to you.
Joy.
Joy. All right. Joy to the world. Joy. Something else.
Jesus.
Reason for the season.
Salvation.
Salvation. What other words?
Love.
Love. Yes, full of love at this season. What else does it mean to you?
Giving.
Yeah. You know, I wait for that answer to come because I have a little theory about giving. It has to do a lot about exercise because giving is kind of an exercise. And so here's my five-line theory about giving. See if you can practice it this season. You give. You give some more. You give until it hurts. You give until it stops hurting. You give until it feels good. And you know, that's just like exercise. When you start to an exercise program, at first it hurts, and then it hurts some more, and then it hurts a whole lot, and then it starts to not hurt, and then after a while, if you don't do it, you don't feel good. So that's the thing about giving, just give. God says when you have open hands and you give, he can fill those hands up higher and bigger than you ever imagined possible. It's only when we clutch hold of what we have that Jesus says, okay, it's yours, but I can't give you any more. So open up those hands this Christmas season. This is what Christmas means to me. We're going to get to you music.
One, two, one, two.
eternal life. This is what Christmas means to me. I once was blind, but now I see. 'Cause our Savior was born on Christmas Day, born to take my sins, take them all away. Came to us one starry night. Now all I want to do is lift His name on high. This is what Christmas means to me. Now there can be joy to the world. Saints rejoice and the angels sing. Emmanuel has come to us. 'Cause our Savior was born on Christmas Day. Born to take my sins, take them all away. Came to earth one starry night. Now all I want to do is lift His name on high.
Shepherd boy, do you hear what?
Well, as we open our Bibles up to Luke chapter 2, you know, I'm reminded that at Christmas time, and I talked about this a little last week, there's this guy called Santa Claus. And if you're a child at heart, then you believe in Santa Claus. At our house, we believe in Santa Claus. In fact, I tell my 35-year-old daughter and my 29-year-old daughter and my 40-year-old son that if they want anything from Santa Claus, they got to believe in him. But here's the thing. You know, once we had Jesus and he was born, and when we realized that after the death of Jesus, it was 400 years until the written version of the Bible that we have today was started. 400 years after the death of Christ. And so when we look at this story, we think, what does the story mean? But here's the thing, you know, the 400 years after the death of Christ puts us in the 5th century. And somewhere along the 5th, 6th century there, a guy is born in Germany. His name is Saint Nicholas. And upon his birth, he grew up in a family that was extremely poor. And as he grew up, he learned the spirit of giving. He was known as an adult as someone who gave to women their dowries when they went to get married. Back in those days, to get married, you actually had to come up with something. You had to have some value as a woman to go and be betrothed to a man. And so St. Nicholas would go around and he would give things to women so that they would be able to have something of worth. And at the end of 33 years, he passed away in Asia Minor, poor and destitute. But the spirit of St. Nicholas, that spirit of giving, is with us today. And we can look back, as I said last week, at Clement Moore, who in 1908 gave Santa Claus a red suit with fur and a corn cob pipe and black boots. And he gave him the ho, 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 and the bell full of jelly that, you know, the belly that shook like a bowl full of jelly. But the spirit of St. Nicholas was still there. And later, he was given reindeer and a sled. But that spirit of St. Nicholas, no matter how much we commercialize it through Santa Claus, is still the spirit that causes me, and I hope it causes you, to want to give more than receive. For when I was a child, I could not wait till Christmas morning to open my gifts. But as a father, and as a brother, and as a husband, I can't wait till Christmas morning to watch the others open their gifts. And so I hope that's what Christmas will be for you. So as we look into Luke chapter 2, we're going to go through in 4 songs here the story of Christmas. So just kind of close your eyes if you want and listen as I read from Scripture. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to his own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child.
The virgin came, we got to him Sunday. child, the Holy One. Is there room for him inside? A welcome chamber to abide. Just a stable cold and bare. Is there room for him somewhere?
Turn back to our story. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn. And every time we get to this point of the story, I think about Mary and Joseph. Now, Joseph, we hear about at the birth, and we don't hear about him too much after that. And Mary, although she was following what God had told her to do, in the midst of knowing that this to their friends and family probably seemed absurd, here they are having a child what looked like originally out of wedlock, but Joseph honors her. And yet, in the midst of it, having a child that's immaculate, placed into Mary's womb by God himself. And although Mary went through the normal childbirth, probably a delivery that had no crying of the baby, for Jesus was perfect, and yet you have to ask yourself, as much as Mary knew she was following God, did she really have an idea of the child that she had just given birth to? Mary, did you know?
Mary, did you know that your baby your baby.
Back to Luke chapter 2, verse 8. The scripture goes on to read, "And there were shepherds living out in their fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, 'Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger.'" We think about this moment, Mary and Joseph, baby Jesus. I think about each perspective. Joseph, the proud father of his firstborn son, probably had his cigars all ready to go to give out to all his friends and relatives. Figuring when he was heading to Bethlehem, he was going to get the penthouse. We're going to be in glory because we are bringing Jesus to mankind. Emmanuel, God with us. And yet he gets there. He can't find a room. And they end up in a stinky, dingy, dark, damp stable. Mary, looking for the sterile environment to have birth back in those days, would have at least been a midwife, maybe some boiled water. Instead, no one there. but Joseph, her, and her child. And yet the shepherds, fearful that they see this angel come to proclaim, says something great has happened. This will be the night that will forever be remembered of the prophecy of the answering of the coming of the Messiah. Emmanuel, God with us. Oh, holy night.
Oh, holy night. The stars are bright, they shine. It is the night of our dear Savior's birth. Long days over. And sin and error pining till he appeared, and the soul felt its worth. As breathed the hope, the weary world rejoices, for yonder breaks a new and glorious morn.
The story, of course, did not end there. For although we've seen Joseph, Mary, Jesus, a single angel and shepherds. There was one last part of the story. Suddenly, a great company of heavenly hosts appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." And with that, the angels singing. And of course, there's no better way to close the story of the birth of Christ than with the angels singing, "Angels we have heard on high," with a twist. And that twist will be the style in which we do it, which is Allah the Who. We hope you enjoy it.
One, two, one, two, three.
And here we now come to Christmas morning, and we sing in retrospect of what has happened. And the next two songs in the form of a medley we're going to do for you is our sing-along for the night. And I know that many times when we sing the first verse of Silent Night, the first verse of Away in the Manger, it's pretty simple. And the second one gets a little tricky. The third one, no one knows. So we're going to do two verses of both songs. And Eric will bless us in the middle with a nice little musical interlude. So with that, if you can just, if you want to stand, stand if you can. We're going to sing Silent Night. We're going to sing Away in the Manger. And we hope that in the midst of this, your Christmas is going to be a joyous one. One that you will not forget. Not just because of 2020 being the year it has been, but because of the people as you look around right now and see those you are with, that this is what you'll remember. Spending Christmas thinking about the birth of Jesus, thinking about giving, thinking about that silent night away in the manger. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild, sleep in heavenly peace, sleep in silent night, holy night. Shepherds quake at the sight, at the sight. Glory streams from heaven above. Heavenly host, sing Christ the Savior is born. Christ the Savior is born. Away in the manger, no crib for a bed. The little Lord Jesus lays down his sweet head. The stars in the sky look down where he lay. The little Lord Jesus asleep on the hay. The cattle are lowing. The cattle are lowing. The baby awakes. But little Lord Jesus, no crying he makes. I love thee, Lord Jesus, look down from the sky and stay by my cradle till morning is nigh. Lord, we just ask you this year that you would bless our Christmases, Lord, that you would bring all that we want to see true, that you would work in each of our hearts to open up in 2021 and be all that you want us to be, Lord. That is our prayer, and we thank you. Amen. If we could all sing Silent Night one more time. Silent night, holy night, all is calm, all is bright round yon virgin mother and child, holy infant so tender and mild. sleep in heaven. Be silent night, holy night. Silent, holy night, silent night. Silent night, holy night. So we're going to go around the horn here. This is kind of like your message time right now. And I'm just going to ask each band member if they could just step to the mic and just share something brief that Christmas means to them. We heard from you. We know what I believe in. So, Eric, could you just step forward and
Say a little bit? Christmas has always been very special in my house. And I grew up with a big celebration and a large family. And but I always remember that that I always knew that something didn't seem quite right because we weren't talking about Jesus all as much as it seemed like I knew about. And it wasn't until my little sister became a Christian, and then I became a Christian, and then I realized, you know, and then it, all of a sudden it had a whole new meaning to me, and ever since.
Melanie?
Oh, I have a nativity set that it's been in my family since I was 2 and my brother was 3. But I remember being a little kid and fighting over holding that baby Jesus in our hand. And it just made us feel so big to hold that little baby Jesus. But it took a while, you know, growing up and everything to realize how big God really is and how minuscule we are, you know. And He just holds the world in His hands, and that's what a reminder to me is at Christmas time.
Judy, could you step over to the mic? Or you have one right there you can talk on. And you'll give that to Dave when you're done. Go ahead and pull it out.
Hi. Christmas, for me, normally in Thailand, we not celebrate Christmas. We celebrate New Year's. So, and when I came over here, you know, 2005 with my first husband, and Christmas, I mean, means so much to me, and all the gifts and trees, and I love it so much. And I can't wait every year, you know, even with Jeff, we have a lot of Christmas present to open, you know, and my hometown, we have just like one each because we're not afford of it. So, and I became to a Christian on 2015. Yeah. And I mean, and I went back home. I share to my families. I want them to be Christian with me, you know, and we accept it, except for my brother, you know, he have to back to work before, you know, we can share everything. So, and I cannot wait to go back and share about Jesus, you know, with them, and share Christmas, you know, with them. So, mean to me. Thank you.
So we're going to hear from Dave, the drummer.
Dave, the drummer. You know, I was sitting here thinking, as everybody was giving their little talk, you know, there's that song, 12 Days of Christmas. And in this time we're in right now where everybody is just not able to be with their loved ones, either they're can't get together because of COVID or something. I just thought of something while I was sitting up here. I thought that when it's 12 days before Christmas, which will be, Bobby, what day will be that starting on? 26 minus 12. The 14th, right? So on the 14th.
25 minus 12.
Huh?
25 minus 12.
25, sorry.
So that's 13.
Anyway, I was just thinking, just every morning when you wake up, just think about the people that you're not going to be able to be with this Christmas because of COVID or something that has arisen. And think about the people that have passed on in your life, your grandparents, your great-grandparents, whatever, that you just aren't going to be able to see. And just say a little prayer for them. And just think about Jesus for 12 days straight every morning. That's it. Have a good Christmas.
Now I'm going to ask David to come up.
So yeah, this is a tough year for me. It's Christmas has always been, you know, really a lot about our family and stuff, our family getting together, and it's always meant a lot to me, just, you know, living alone and stuff. And this year with 2020, it's been getting, as my nieces have been getting older, we've started doing less Christmases together, and this one's just, you know, kind of going to be tough to tell you the truth of, you know, not getting together with family and stuff. Maybe we will, maybe we won't, but obviously as a Christian, I'm one of the only Christians in my family, my immediate family, I am the only one. So it's been a blessing that since I've come to know the Lord, I've shared Christmas stories with them. I've dragged them to church and stuff. So it's been a blessing to be used that way in the family. And obviously, I try to keep the focus that Jesus is the reason for the season. But just pray for my family. Pray they come to know Jesus as their Savior and that they know He's the true reason for the season.
So 1956, take you back a while. Seems so last century, doesn't it? That was the year I was born. To a mother and father, my dad, he was the last of 11 children, born in 1920. So you can imagine all his brothers and sisters born quite a bit before that, some before in the 19th century, so last two centuries ago. And my mother was second to the last in her family. So by the time all their brothers and sisters were having kids, they were still growing up. And lo and behold, 1950, my mom and dad had their first child. That was my sister, Pam. She passed away in 2005. But Pam was 12 years younger than the next closest cousin. And it wasn't for 8 more years until I was 6 more years that I was born. And so by the time I came along, everybody in the family outside of my sister was pretty much grown. And we went back east and spent a few Christmases back in the South, back in New Orleans with my dad's family, back in Virginia with my mom's family. And I was pretty much the only one that was seeing Santa Claus, you know, when we would actually be back there on Christmas Day. And I look back at that and I think about the joy of a family being around. And over the years, 1997, my dad got sick. 2002, he passed. My first wife, Cindy's dad, passed in 2002. My sister passed in 2005, as I had said. Cindy's brother passed in 2005. Then her stepdad, her stepmom, 2007, 2009. My mom in 2010. And then my first wife, Cindy, in 2012 passed. And it took me about 6 months to come to the realization that first Christmas without her, that I had gone from being the youngest to being the only one left. And everyone in my family was now younger than me. And it takes on a perspective. Because when I was young, I used to always worry, what's going to happen when my mom and dad are gone? What am I going to do when I have problems? And I realized what happens is we all have a role in life. And about the time that I started to realize that I no longer had anybody to look up to, I simply turned around and realized how many were looking up to me. That example of Christianity, that example of Christ within you, is the example that I want you to share this year. For there are those who are past, as Dave said, but there are those that still exist. Enjoy them. Treasure them. Take the moments that Dave said each day before Christmas and thank God for what you have. And then remember, the good news is that one day, as a believer in Christ, we will all be in heaven together. And that party goes on forever. And there's no COVID-19. Amen. Nothing to stop us from being able to celebrate. So with that, I'm going to pray. And if you just bow your heads and close your eyes, I'm going to pray for your Christmas. Dear Heavenly Father, we just come to you tonight. And we thank you for the story that you give us in the book of Luke. We thank you for your servant, Joseph and Mary. We thank you for John the Baptist. We thank you for him bringing Christ into baptism. For us as believers to choose to be baptized so we can show the rest of the world what we believe in. We thank you that at that birth, you set into motion something that was going to change mankind forever. And amazingly, even though Jesus lived 33 years, Lord, you didn't just take 33 years. You let him grow up and be prepared, and it wasn't until the last 3 years of his life you sent him into ministry. He amazed everyone as he grew up, but it was those final 3 years. The stories that we read through Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, where we hear of what Jesus has come to give us, to show us the way, to lead us to eternity. And then upon his leaving and ascending to heaven, he gives us the biggest job we could possibly imagine. That through ordinary people that we are, we have the extraordinary opportunity to share what Jesus has done in our lives so that someone might open their heart and let Jesus share it in their life. So as we leave 2020 behind, Lord, may we pick all those things that have made us stronger, both good and bad. May we take them into 2021, and may we be warriors for you this coming year as we share your name to all those that we come in contact with. Lord, as we sing this last song, we ask that you would bless the offering that they're taking, that you would use it to be able to glorify your kingdom, that love on fire will become known more than it is already, that people from all over El Cajon, from all over San Diego County, from here to Africa and beyond, would hear and know the love of love on fire. And that because of that, they will see Jesus doing extraordinary things through people who many in the world have written off. And yet, Jesus uses them for miracles in other people's lives. We thank you and we praise you, Lord. May this last song be a happy one. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Do we have a basket to bring forward tonight? Oh, it's out. All right. So this last song we're going to do, from 1970. If you're my age or if you're younger, you've heard this song. It's from a guy named Jose Feliciano. And we're going to sing Feliz Navidad. We hope you enjoy it.
Feliz Navidad, oh, 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 Feliz Navidad, prospero año.
Christmas. Merry Christmas from New Beginnings Band to all of you out there.
Amen, amen. Feliz Navidad. Hallelujah. All of you out there that are watching on our YouTube, all of you that are out there, we, everybody, let's go. We want to wish you
a Merry Christmas. God bless you. We have one more song for you tonight, because although Christmas is going to still come, you know what comes after Christmas that we celebrate next? And we want to leave you with a song for Easter called Saving the World, about a man dying on the cross, saving the world. Put your hands together. We're gonna pick it up. Here we go. So many preachers, so many churches and denominations got their opinions and their documents and statements and beliefs. Sometimes there's a miscommunication, so we complicate the truth and we convolute the story. But as far as I recall, I do believe it all comes down to a man dying on the cross, saving the world. Rising from the dead, doing what he said he would do. Loving everyone he saw, when he said and done, it all comes. I'm just being simple-minded, but it's about Jesus and the way, the truth, the life that can change a heart and soul forever. And we need to be reminded it's the power of the blood that brings us to redemption. We can rise above the fall, and the reason for it all comes down to a man dying on the cross, saving the world, rising from the dead. When it's said and done, it all comes down to a man dying on the cross, saving the world. All the people beneath the steeple are just reaching for the truth that can save a helpless soul. Remember one thing, it all comes down to a man dying on the cross, saving the world, rising from the dead, doing what he said he would do, loving everyone he saw. When it's said and done, it all comes down to a man dying on the cross, saving the world. We will see you on January 4th. Be praying that this is going to get over with this lockdown. We get back to it in 2021. God bless you all from all of us up here. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year. We'll be praying for you. Enjoy it.
Do the games, man. We love you guys. We love the heart. We love the spirit that you bring. We appreciate you so much. And what a story. What a testimony that is. That is just beautiful. And Jeff, we love you. I've known Jeff 20 years, and I from afar have seen the hills and valleys he's been through, and you've been a light shining out of darkness the whole way. And amen, praise the Lord for that. So I just want to share with all of you Merry Christmas, and those of you once again out there that are stuck in your homes, you know, we aren't going anywhere. We're here. We love you, and we want to wish you a Merry Christmas, and we look forward to next year when this place is full, where you're all able to come out. We are going to stay. We're not going anywhere. You can trust that when that time comes, we will be here. You cannot worry, do not fret. When that door time comes, our doors are going to fly open with anxious hearts awaiting you to come. So we as a team want to wish you a very, very, very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. You know, as we went around and we heard these beautiful stories and these beautiful testimonies, I wanted to cry because as you were sharing of people that have passed away, and you know, about this time we would be heading down to Mexico to my wife's family's house and to my family down in Mexico, a big family, a beautiful family, and this Christmas we are so grateful to the Lord, but we're celebrating this Christmas without Rosie's mom. And as much as it hurts, we still have to remember the reason for the season is Jesus. And I pray that, oh, Cody, I love you, brother. I love you, Cody. Thank you very much. And that Jesus will see us through any challenge, all the challenges of this past year. And this was going to be part of my message next week. And just you all got a flyer. We due to some of the stuff going on, we are taking next week off and the next 2 weeks after. And Jeff could explain the whole thing to you. He explained it to me really beautiful today, but we're not going to get into that. We're going to get into the fact that we can't wait to see you back.
And with that, Bobby, I want you to keep in mind that you can go to YouTube and look up New Beginnings Band, because not only do we have recordings on there, we're going to do one more before the end of the year, so you can actually enjoy that. But more importantly, come New Year's Eve, we're on live.
From Angel City.
So join us at 7:30. It's going to be either 7:30 or 10 on New Year's Eve. We'll let you know. It will be posted on our Facebook page. But we just want you to know we come from our garage with love for all of you.
So. And where are you going to be playing on New Year's?
Bellflower, California, Angel City Cafe. If it's all open. If not, we'll be doing it in my garage.
At midnight.
We're supposed to be playing 10 to midnight. But if not, it'll be 7:30 to 10 if they want to stop early.
Wow.
But if we can't get up to Bellflower, we will be in our garage.
Amen.
Look forward to New Year's Eve.
Amen. Well, we look forward to that. And as I was sharing, no matter what's gone on throughout this last year, no matter how challenges, how hard things have gotten for you, how great things have gotten for you, I want you to know that God has a plan for each one of us. His plan is to prosper us and not to harm us, plan for a hope and a future. And that's his plan. None of the stuff that goes on, none of the challenges, that is not his plan for you. His plan is not for you to be hopeless. His plan for you is to be filled with hope, knowing
that he is our King of Kings and he is our Lord of Lords.
Amen.
So know, once again, from each one of our team, I would go around and everyone would have something great to share, but we'll do that when we come back on New Year's, share with you how excited we are. So as we say goodbye, I would like everybody to stand up, look back at this camera in the back, and I want everybody, as loud as you can, when I say, to tell everybody Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Come on up here. Come on up here. Come on, Jason. We don't want you to ever think that you are forgotten because you can't come here to Love on Fire. We can't wait for you to come back. And from all of us, to all of you, we want to say, Merry Christmas!